Thank you very much for keeping it live with us right here on Urban Today, on Urban Television. Now, this morning, we're going to be talking about labor, the dynamics of labor in the country. And whenever we talk about labor, we do not forget both the employees and the employers, as these do form the working sector. Now, today on the show, I have two particular individuals, very brilliant as far as this topic is concerned. One coming in from the International Labour Organization, going by the names of Jacqueline Banya. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
How is your Wednesday morning?
It's very fine. We're looking forward to the main celebration this afternoon.
That's fantastic. And then, of course, you can't talk about labor without getting into the Ministry of Labor, Gender and Social Works. Good morning to you, Mr. Asimwe Alex.
Yes, good morning. Good morning, Urban TV.
How is your morning?
Fantastic.
Great. Now that we're talking about labor, we're talking about the dynamics of labor in the country, both import and export wise. I want us to first come back to, of course, you, Madam Jacqueline, and give us a bit of information that we need to know about International Labor Organization.
Thank you very much. And I'd like also to thank all the viewers. Mm. The International Labor Organization is one of the oldest UN agencies. Mm-hmm. Established in 1919, and from 1919 to 2019, that is hence 100 years.
100 years, yes.
Yeah. Mm. It was built on the premise and the belief that universal and lasting peace can only be established if it is based on social justice. Mm. So in brief, it's for the pursuit of social justice, and here we mean better living and working conditions for everyone. Okay. Everywhere in the world, because poverty anywhere in the world constitutes a danger to prosperity everywhere.
Okay,
this is the belief.
All right, 100 years of existence. Asimwe, how has the Ministry of Labour, you as a commissioner coming in from that particular one, how have you guys worked hand in hand together with the International Labour Organization to make sure that you fully provide for both the employers and the employees in the country?
First of all, we recognize the importance of workers and employers. Mm-hmm. And ILO has been very useful because of its mandate in putting in place standards, and of which those standards we have domesticated them. Now, those standards, first of all, promote decent work, but also are very critical in enabling us to put in place an environment that can create work. And as you know, that we all derive our livelihoods from work.
Yes, that's true.
And that has been very, very fundamental. Mm. And one of the key principles and key programs and projects of government, you have seen them very clearly. One, enabling environment goes with infrastructure development. Mm. That you must have electricity, you must have roads, you must have water, you must have security. Then after there, then you must also have the human resource developed. We have UPE that is in place. We have UCE that is in place. Mm. And we continuously upskill our workers. And that's not to say that we only look at workers, but also recognize that these workers, one, they must be self-employed, but those who cannot employ themselves, they require to be employed
yes.
And that therefore we come in to support employers, give them the environment they require. You know, we have an employment policy, we have the labor laws, and we ensure that the work we do is in a tripartite. Tripartite means that we sit on table, we have workers, we have employers, and government. Now we decide and dialogue on how best employers can advance their interest, how best the workers can advance their interest. And as government, we have achieved in that manner. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see the number of graduates going high, the number of employed people is going high. Mm. And you know, from the GDP, if you look at our GDP, you know, we are now close to about $30 billion, meaning that the workers of this country, the employers of this country, are doing a lot, courtesy in part of how this labor, International Labor Organization has been supporting us to ensure that we put these systems and procedures.
Mr. Simo, I want us to come back to the dynamics and how you are doing this particular one, because I believe not every worker or, you know, every employee right there is actually feeling contented with what they are doing right about now. But I want us to, you know, throw more light on the dynamics that you're doing. But immediately after Jackie has explained to us why this particular thing, we understand today you have an event that, of course, where you'll be celebrating 100 years of existence and still availing more information to both the workers and the different employees coming in from different organizations. The future of work in Uganda, that is your theme today.
Thank you very much. Mm. And once more, I like to, you know, repeat that 100 years is what we are celebrating.
Yes.
And the main celebration was marked this year in June at the International Labour Conference, where Uganda is also a member. And a future work report was launched as one of the key, actually at the center of this centenary celebration, to guide the world of work for the next period, because it's been a long time. 1919 to 2019 has been a long time, and a lot of changes have taken place in the world of work. And these changes, technological, the climate change, the environment has changed. So many things have changed in the way work is done. But like he mentioned, the tripartite nature of the ILO, it means it's the very source of strength of the organization, because the employers on the one hand, the government, and the workers of the entire 187 member states, when they come together and they agree on anything, on any policy, he talked about standards, which is one of the mechanism through which ILO comes to work together with member states. And looking through all the many years, changes have taken place where some of the standards have had to be revised, have had to be updated to cope with the changes. So what we are celebrating, the future of work looks into what kind of work do we want to, you know, what kind of changes do we need to make in order to assure that we can, to ensure that we can have the decent, productive, freely chosen employment, the decent work that we advocate for, and the decency at the heart of it all. We have the standards, the labor standards, we have the fundamental principles and rights at work, we call them briefly, which really embody fundamental issues, human rights issues in the area of labor that need to be respected. And and, you know, just to mention a few, we have the freedom of association and the right of workers to bargain collectively to determine the terms and conditions of work.
Okay.
We have the freedom from child labor as one of the key fundamental principles. We have the freedom from discrimination. We have the freedom from forced labor. These are the fundamental principles that, fortunately, Uganda has actually signed up and ratified all these critical, what we call the core labor standards. So just to focus back on the point, the centenary is being celebrated, and the future of work is at the heart of it, because it's like a roadmap that gives us, along with it, I like to mention the declaration. The declaration, the future of work, was launched, and this gives prescribes like recommendations that member states would take forward. For example, in the area of employment, to have a freely productive chosen employment, what is happening? There's a lot of skills gaps, the upskilling, the skilling of the young people, and making sure that, you know, it's lifelong learning that needs to take place, because technology keeps changing.
That's true. That's
so it's
true.
A lifelong learning. How do we cope with the changes?
I want us to talk about technology. It's one of the things that I had noted down for us to talk about, vis-a-vis people getting replaced by all this technology you're talking about and machines. But that's going to be a bit later on. Coming back to you, Mr. Simo, the dynamics of, you know, how you're bringing together the workers, the different employees, employers, the government. How are you doing this? How are you making it possible to see that these three bodies always come together and they have their interests at heart?
Number one is that we have a framework. We have the tripartite charter, and this charter provides mechanism of how we meet and dialogue and advance our interests. And this charter provides a foundation of discussion of key issues. For example, issues to do with the dispute settlement, issues to do with employment creation, issues to do with the labor productivity, issues to do with freedom of association. As you know, our constitution is very clear. You know, Article 40 and 29, you know, provide the freedom of, you know, association and ability of employees to be able to join unions of their choice. So these important issues, like even youth employment, as you know, 73% or so is, you know, of the labor force, you know, of our population is young people. So it provides us that mechanism of being able to resolve these important issues without, you know, seeing strikes and, you know, disagreements. And we handle all these issues in our boardroom, employers, workers, and government. That's the way how we do things.
And do you think that different workers on different levels of employment get to have access to this information for their betterness in terms of service delivery?
Absolutely, because you see, what we do is that when you look at the mandate of the ministry responsible for labor, we have what we call a division for inspectorate. Now we do what we call labor inspection. In fact, this place has never been inspected.
Okay.
Now, what we use is that when we inspect, we also undertake what we call enterprise-based inspection and training and sensitization. So we've been able to train workers, still sensitize them on their rights, but also importantly, we've been able to support employers to ensure that they are able to know the standards and they are able to ensure that the rights of workers are adhered to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's come back to you, Jackie. And I believe that down at International Labour Organization, one of the main roles or objectives is to promote social work, decent work, and get people jobs on merit. How are you doing this? How can you convince someone that down at International Labour Organization, as you get to celebrate 100 years, this is actually happening and it has benefited a couple of people? How do you make this pass?
Yeah, just to re-echo the fact that this organization is tripartite. We have the governments, the employers, and the workers. So what the ILO, at ILO, we support the formulation of policies, of the laws that that would promote the decent work. That is how we do it. So that this the decent work that we're talking about, when it's broken down in a nutshell, really for everybody, it's not something that you cannot define in one. What is the decency here? If you have, you can afford, be able to afford a decent life and earning, that's why we talk of productive, freely chosen, you know, employment that can afford you all the basics of life. And so what we do, the policies that shape the way that, that govern the world of work, we support the governments in the formulation of those policies in terms of the technical support, together with the workers, with the employers, because every policy that has been agreed upon by the three, it means therefore that they've endorsed it and they'll support it. They have the buy-in and then implementation becomes a lot easier. If one, and another thing very important also, the capacity building, the social dialogue that he talked about is something that is a very key tool that is used, because it's a harmonious working relation whereby the three parties discuss, they sit on a round table and agree on the framework that should govern every issue to do with the area of work. And we have this issue of course, unemployment is a big issue today, especially for the youth, the young.
What do you think has attributed to the high numbers of unemployment? Is it the lack of skills? Is it the lack of organizations and institutions to employ these people? Where would you attribute the biggest cause of unemployment in the country now?
Well, this is something that I cannot answer in one sentence, because unemployment is a very huge thing, and the number of factors definitely that contribute to unemployment. But from the technical point of view, we're looking at skills, some of the skills gap, whereby the employers don't have the appropriate skills that are necessary due to this, you know, technical. If take the example of the oil, the oil sector. We have had, I think you're familiar with the fact that some of these rare skills in that sector has been wanting or lacking. So you find that to upskill, to skill our people, the right skills to match with the right demand for the job, the job market is another thing altogether. So you find that the unemployment sometimes is due to the the appropriate skills needed lacking. Could be skills gap. And of course, we don't have enough jobs being created. So the institutions of learning are always turning out.
It's more of a two-way thing.
It's a two-way thing, definitely.
Okay. I want us to come back to technology. And of course, understanding that the world is evolving. Every day something new comes up. Machines are unveiled to simplify man's work. Should we as human beings or the people that are capable of being employed, should we get scared of this technology? What is even our future of, you know, employment if we have this technology keeping on evolving? There's machines coming in to replace man. Should we be worried about the future of employment in this country?
I think worrying has never solved any problem. We should not be worried because technology is good, it's a good thing.
Okay.
And this advancement is something we cannot stop. It's moving very fast. The technological advancement is moving very fast, and we need to learn to cope with it. So the coping mechanism, that is why the declaration, the future of work, comes up with recommendations.
Okay.
Because it's encouraging innovation, creativity. It's something we cannot run away from. I think we should not get scared, but rather it has a positive thing in that productivity is increasing. And what does it mean? It means therefore that there should be a lot of strategies to create more jobs if the technological advancement taking place. So jobs in those areas, it means the upskilling, which I'm talking about, the skilling with the right, with the right skills that are required to cope up with this technological advancement.
Right.
Of course, there can never be enough jobs.
Mm.
But also, I think we are lucky we have the Commissioner for Labour here, and he did touch about the issue of what they're doing with the other partners in deciding the future in terms of what is the requirement for this country in terms of labor.
So we shouldn't get freaked out because of the technological bit?
No, we should not, because it's something we cannot stop.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Now, coming back to you, Mr. Simo, when we talk about, you know, employment and understanding that we have three principles or three big sectors that are playing this part, that is the employer, the employees, and the government. We cannot go without talking about the minimum wage bill. This was a bill that was in parliament as far as, you know, the minimum wage is concerned. What happened? It had a natural death. It was something the workers were excited for, and then at the end of the day, we did not see what came out.
No, I think what I would like to say is that I would like to talk about what government we are doing.
Yes.
What we are doing is that we have a board, the minimum wages, you know, advisory board. This board undertook a study. And this study made some recommendations in regard to the minimum wage. Now the report was submitted to cabinet, and cabinet discussed that report and requested for more information. And we are now putting together that information to go back to cabinet.
Okay.
And then once it is gone to cabinet and has been approved, then we'll go ahead and put in place a minimum wage. So what I can tell you is that number one, the government of Uganda is strongly looking forward to have a minimum wage.
Okay.
Two, the government of Uganda knows that they are vulnerable workers in informality, but also they are vulnerable workers in some workplaces that need to be protected. But most importantly, government is aware that for workers to be competitive, number one is that your skill, let me tell you, your skill, the way how you know how to do work is the one that determines how much you'll be paid by employer.
Okay.
Even if we set a minimum wage of, say, 200,000 or 400,000, but once you are skilled, once you have rare attributes that an employer requires, you can say, please, I need 5 million. And the employer, once he sees that you are profitable,
and there is potential,
he will give you that money. So government is moving forward to ensure that supports employers, puts in place mechanism of improving our workforce such that they are competitive. Don't forget that even because of globalization, and you have heard that the African Union, for instance, we have gone into a thinking of free movement of goods and labor. That means that you will have Egyptians working here, and Ugandans going somewhere else to work.
Mm-hmm.
Even in East African community, we have that common market, you know, free movement of labor.
Yes.
So that means that a minimum wage, whereas you people in the private sector and workers can look at minimum wage as very key and a critical thing. Yes, it is very central, but there is another big one that once you are empowered enough, then that minimum wage, you can ask whatever you want.
Skill is very key. Quite interesting. We do get to wrap up, over to you, Jacqueline, we're celebrating 100 years. Where is this function going to be? What should we expect? And who is eligible to attend?
I think the eligibility for attendance is based on invitation.
Okay, oh, invitation.
Mm. Yes, mm. At the venue is the Sheraton Hotel,
mm-hmm.
Kampala Sheraton Hotel.
Mm.
And we are starting at 2:00,
okay.
Where we will expect some panelists.
Mm-hmm.
And some presentations on the future of work report.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I think maybe I didn't mention the human-centered approach, which is a key thing in the future of work. And it will be highlighted, and members present who will be there will be able to appreciate and to understand what is at the heart of this future, having a human-centered approach to handling the future of work. The thing which I've been trying to explain all along,
yes,
investing more in human capital, skilling, reskilling, upskilling, lifelong learning, so that you can leverage on the changes in the world of, you know, technological changes in the world.
All right, thank you very much, Jacqueline Banya, for coming through to studio, as well as Alex Asimu, for that quiteful, delighted information. And for you who may not have gotten the invite, at least I believe you have one, two things to remember out of this conversation. And the first one should be skill. As long as you're empowered with your skill, you can definitely be able to build it anywhere, at any time, at any place. Urban Today goes in for a very short break, but remember, the future of workers and of course our work and industry does begin with you as far as empowering yourself is concerned. We'll see you for more information, and of course up next will be the love letter right here on Urban Today.